with her incredible co-host, Stacie, Terrence, Open Source Gallery, and all of the folks who make it possible. Everybody, please welcome Christina. Where are you, Christina?
Hello.
I have to spotlight you.
You can spotlight me. I'm great
there
at a
are.
Spotlight. Can anybody tell I'm an actor? So I'm going to tell a story that is not often told, especially in America, especially now. I'm going to tell a story about receiving good healthcare from someone who was affordable at a walk-in clinic. I don't think I've ever heard a story like it, frankly, which makes me very sad. But it starts way back in last year. I was really excited to go with my husband to Utah, from New York to Utah, which was exciting just because I never in my life imagined I would be in Utah, let alone for a marathon, which is not something that I do, but something that I had watched him prepare for long and hard for a long time. He had gotten to the point where he was real sick of it and real done and just so over it. So we go to Utah, we camp in the desert in below freezing temperatures. We end up in the car. The next day it's 4 o'clock in the morning and off he goes to run the marathon, dragging his feet. And I'm sitting, waiting, because I'm not running a goddamn marathon. I run for the bus. Maybe. He comes back and crosses the line and is so proud, so proud that I kind of understood afterwards why he would do it. We met in Utah. His father and stepmom came down to meet him at the finish line. And we continued on to do a little bit of a Southwest tour, which was really exciting because I'm Australian. Cowboys are a myth that are so pervasive. Like, I didn't understand how much I loved them until I understood how ridiculous and terrifying they were. Like, as a cultural narrative, I was like, I didn't understand what they meant. So we go through Arches National Park and we go through Dead Horse Point National Park and it's so beautiful. We go through canyonlands and into these remote parts of the country that I truly couldn't have described to you before I went there. And in one area of canyonlands, we find this old cowboy camp. And there was a relic of, you know, a fire being set up and the whole myth is established in these few tokens to like the Wild West. And I was looking around the camp and I was looking in everything. I was so curious. And I lifted the lid of what I was like, this is a box, of course, look in the box. It's like an adventure park. And I lifted the lid and I scraped my finger on a nail and I was like, oh man, I'm so tough. I'm at a cowboy park. I've got a scraped finger from a rusty nail, like great. And we continue on our adventures. We go to the Grand Canyon. This is truly an American road trip. We go to the Grand Canyon and Andrew and I hike down almost to the river and then back up in the day. And it was something that connected me with America in a very overwhelming way, in a way that the natural world has only ever been able to make me understand the gravity of this place and the breadth of it. So we hike in and we hike back out again and it's sunset and it's beautiful. And of course we haven't had any reception. We've been in the middle of the Grand Canyon. Who needs reception in the Grand Canyon? And I turn my phone on again, and I see the message that my husband's grandfather has died. And he hasn't got this message yet. So he's off in the gift shop, and I go in. Like, shit, we're in this place where we're excited about getting a t-shirt, right? Okay, cool. I take him out, relay the news. We head back to New York, and we go to the funeral, and we go through all the steps. This is New York in November last year, before death really, really enveloped the city. And so it was a real shift to be thinking about, you know, our relationships and how fleeting they can be, even if they're long, how much you want to reach for them. We were in a moment where it wasn't all around us, the all pervasive feeling. And so it was a bit of a shock to be in that space. And I go back to work, and I start getting these horrible stomach pains, this tightness in my neck, and this kind of headache that just doesn't go away. And I think back to when I was at Canyonlands and that little scrape that I had on my finger, and I think, oh shit. The headaches don't stop, the tightness in my joints, I start to get like my chest, I can't breathe properly. This is going over a couple of days, this escalates. And I keep thinking about that little cut on my finger from that rusty nail. And I keep thinking, oh my God, I've got tetanus. I latch onto this. I've got tetanus, of course, shit, fuck, I'm gonna die. And I sit on this for a few more days, and eventually I'm at work, and I'm just puking everywhere. I have to leave. It gets to the point where I'm lying in bed and I hear a knock at the door, and I can't go down the stairs because I'm so ill. And my partner comes home the day I left work and looks at me and is like, right, we're going to the clinic. You can't say no anymore. You have to see someone. This is terrible. If you've got tetanus, like, let's go. My husband, by the way, has the dedication of like, no one I've ever seen before. He's run marathons, you know, he works incredibly. He also has the patience of a saint dealing with somebody panicking and not going to the doctor because, oh my God, I'm in America. Like, I can't go to the doctor. I can. I'm in a very privileged position of having healthcare, like, but still that narrative is pervasive. And so he takes me in an Uber. I think it's snowing. I can't remember, but I remember it being fucking cold. And I'm holding on to my guts the whole way in the car. I get out and I retch into the gutter in Park Slope. I go in. I'm freaking out because I can't breathe in the waiting room in the waiting room at CityMD. Like, I'm at a walk-in clinic. Like, I'm not going to get, no one's going to see me. Like, what? No one's going to know what's going on. And we got quickly admitted, and in walks this young, calm doctor who sits down and looks me in the eyes and says, so you got tetanus. Okay. Is anything stressful been going on? No, nothing stressful. Any death in the family? Well, yes. And it starts to unravel that, oh yes, a death in the family. Oh my God, I've got a trip coming up that I'm doing on my own for the first time. I'm going to be on my own for the first time in years, and I'm going to be away for a month. And all of these things, all of these stresses, all of these weights start to appear in my vision. I start to see what's going on, and I just fall apart. And I'd been holding on to a panic attack for like 3 days. I didn't have tetanus. Well, I didn't have tetanus. I was having a panic attack.
God bless you.
I needed this person who had some uniform on to put a hand on my shoulder and say that it's okay to feel what you're feeling. Because I'd internalized everything into this narrative that I was going to die. But it was just pain. It was just pain. And so he very calmly talked me through getting a little booster shot, just in case, just for the next time I was sure it was tetanus. He gave me a shot. He said, go see a fucking therapist. It's time. And I don't think I will ever forget how calm and legitimate I felt walking out of there, which was absolutely contrary to every other experience I have ever had with a doctor, to feel validated. But that's how it should be. That's how it should be. So thank you. If you're feeling nervous, it's okay. And look after your mental health. Sometimes gut problems are anxiety. So just...
Thank you, Christina.
What's his name? Because that's my neighborhood.
Oh my God. Okay. So I have no idea what his name is. I've been racking my brain because I don't know who he is. He's like my fairy god doctor.
Just Google right. My fairy god doctor.
Yeah.
I thought that's the end was going to be that you were pregnant, but.
No, I mean,
the that's answer, a really good way no, to Reese. Hey, Reese.
It seems like the answer to everything is like, how about you lose 10 pounds and also are you pregnant? But no, it was legitimately mental health problems. But once, it wasn't lose 10 pounds, are you pregnant? Which was just really great. In order to clip along, Stacie, my love, can I introduce you?
Oh, yes. Sorry, I'm settling in like I don't have anything to do. Yes, you can introduce.
Wonderful. Everybody, I would just love you to take a breath and look at the incredible person in front of you, Stacie.
That's not in my bio.
Oh, no, it's not, but it's definitely in my heart. For you. So just everybody take a minute. Mwah. Stacie Evans is incredible. Stacie believes in mangoes, pomegranates, and watermelon. Stacie believes that mangoes, pomegranates, and watermelon are the fruit proofs of the existence of God. She hasn't kissed nearly enough people and worries that COVID will mean that sad fact remains true. Stacie is a writer, and that is why, instead of moving through the streets like Beyonce and her baseball bat, she uses pen and paper, each word a chisel, a chainsaw, a bludgeon. There's a lot that needs to be raised to the ground. Stacie hopes she'll be remembered for the white heat of her rage, for taking the molten core of that rage and crushing it into a magnificent diamond. A year of hosting How to Build a Fire has taught her about trust, openness, and the magic of focusing on one another and really listening. She comes to her final hosting night remembering that there is love and the possibility of laughter, and that How to Build a Fire is a warm and excellent embrace. She believes in ghosts. She believes in love. She believes that each of us can, if we really want to. And I believe that she is one of the most brilliant people that I have ever met. Mwah! Stacie Evans.
Oh my God. Thank you, Christina.
Sorry, I love you.
So I'm blushing now, but also sending lots of love back out to you. So I'm gonna tell a story. So 2 weeks from today, exactly 2 weeks from today, it's my birthday. It's very exciting for me. And you know, birthdays are like our annual time to think about transitions and to take stock. And so like a lot of people do, I spend the time leading up to my birthday kind of reflecting on what did I do last year and what are some things that I want to really focus on as I move into my new year. And if you, like me, have a big milestone birthday coming up in a few years, then you are thinking more than just about this 1 year's birthday, but you're thinking about what that new decade of your life is gonna bring and what that's gonna be like. So in 2 weeks, I'm gonna be 58. And so the big milestone birthday that, you know, staring down at me is 60. And I've been thinking about moving into, I'm not even looking at your faces, trust me, I am, no one lies and says they're gonna be 60, I'm not gonna be 60. Trust me, I am exactly as old as I say. and this wasn't supposed to be part of the story, but I'm gonna say this. If I had any doubt about whether or not I am an old person, I was this, like, before COVID, I was like walking on the street in Manhattan and these two young teenage boys were like coming really fast toward me. And one of them, not looking where he was going, just slammed right into me. It's like body slammed by this 14-year-old boy. And as he kind of like reset himself and like was about to move on with his friend, he says to his friend, "I ran right into that lady's boob," which was true. He like body slammed my boob. And his friend was like, "Did you touch it?" And I was so mortified by that idea. And he was like, "Touch it? She was old." Accurate. That was true. So I'm officially old. It's, you know, undeniable evidence from the mouth of a 14-year-old boy. And anyway, back to my story. So I've been thinking about what is it going to mean for me to be old. Like I'm planning for it and thinking about what I want to bring with me into this next phase of my life. And I am fortunate because I am descended from a long line of incredibly amazing elder women. And so I'm looking at them and thinking about what are the things that I see in them and the ways that they embodied being old that I want to take with me into my old age. And I mean, not like 60 is old age, but you know, I plan to get a whole lot older than 60. So this is like the the beginning of that path. So I think about my father's mother, Eva, and you know, one of the things that I know is that without having to do anything, I bring Eva with me into my old age because I look like her. I have her face, I have her body, her hands. So I'm carrying her with me in that way into the future. But then I also think of things that were true about her as a person that I aspire to have be true about me. One of the things that I really loved about her was that she didn't have like a big loud temper. Like she wasn't like this explosive, "I'm gonna get in your face and yell at you about shit" kind of person. I'm sure she experienced lots of anger and felt lots of anger about lots of different things, but she processed her anger really differently than a lot of other people in my family. And for years, I thought, "Ooh, I've inherited this from her because everybody always thinks I'm so calm and I never get mad." But that has actually been proven to be entirely not true. I have like a pretty aggressive temper at this point. And I don't want to get rid of that. I am very happy about feeling and expressing my anger when I have it. But what I aspire to is mom's ability to process that and figure out how she wanted to move forward from it so that she was running her anger and her anger wasn't running her. And I'm definitely not in that place yet. So I aspire to that. I also aspire to her incredible green thumb. Like, she was the growingest person I have ever met in my life. She had an extraordinary garden, both outside and inside her house. And I for sure do not have that, as evidence the many plants that I have killed during quarantine. Like, I'm just, it's very sad, the situation for the plants in my life right now. I am keeping some alive in my office, but the ones in my house, one by one, are all going into the trash. So I absolutely aspire to that ability to nurture growing things and not kill them. And then I think about my maternal grandmother, Ethi. And I always have thought that Ethi is the person that I take the most from, which is not true, because all three of the people I'm going to talk about, I have taken things from. But Ethi was a person who loved to and was really skilled at making things with her hands. And I have that skill too. Like, put any craft in front of me and I'm going to learn how to do it, and I'm going to do it obsessively until I can do it really well. Like, from making paper to making Ukrainian Easter eggs to, like, whatever, I'm gonna learn how to do it. I'm going to have fun doing it. I have a giant closet that is only full of craft supplies because I just have so much crap in my house that is related to the different crafts that I do. Which is why at the start of lockdown, I was able to make masks for my neighbors and my friends and for that one Lyft driver who I had a really nice conversation with, because I have this huge fabric stash and why not use that? So I definitely take that from my grandmother. She was far more skilled than I am, but I aspire to getting better. She also had a love for learning languages. She didn't have an extensive formal education, but, you know, I have the books that she used to study from, and she taught herself French and Spanish and Italian and Hebrew and Portuguese and Russian, and I think German also. I am way behind her on this list. I have not started to learn even half of those languages, but I love learning languages, and I have a facility for it, which I think definitely comes from her. And she also was a writer, not in the way that I am a writer. But she wrote long, long, incredible letters in her beautiful, stunning handwriting. I do not have stunning handwriting. I mean, it's all right, but it's not like that. But I love the fact that she wrote such involved letters. Like, she could have just written a quick check-in. Here's what's going on with me. How are you? Half a page and on. But she wrote pages-long letters that went deep into whatever she was thinking about. And that valuing of writing things down and really, like, focusing on something, that I think is definitely something that I connect to as a writer and that I feel comes from her. And then there's my aunt, my mother's older sister, Mildred. I know that my friend Diane is in the Zoom room tonight, and Diane is evidence that I talk about Mildred all the time. Diane and I went to the Botanic Garden last week, and I don't even know, did I say Mildred's name like 500 times in the time we were walking around the Botanic Garden? So she's always on my mind. And one of the things that I feel most strongly about that I know that I have taken from her is Mildred spent her whole career as a teacher. She was a science teacher, a biologist. And I know that my career in education is directly tied to what I know about her as a teacher. And not just, you know, imparting information, but also the way that she was so invested in her students. The way that the stories that people told about being in her class when we were at her funeral, it was so obvious that it wasn't just, oh, I learned some science stuff from Miss Brooks. It was like, Miss Brooks saw me. Miss Brooks loved me. Like the way that she could focus on her students and nurture her students just was so powerful. And I want to believe that I also was able to give that to the students that I taught. And like Mildred, I don't have any children, but I do have a niece and nephew who I adore beyond measure. And in the way that for me, Mildred was a great example of how to be an independent, curious, really smart, really giving, and just generally amazing human, and how she was able to be all of those things as a Black woman in a world that didn't make a lot of space or allowances for Black women. Like that example that she set for me, I hope that I am able to set that example for my niece and nephew, that this is who we can be in the world. And as I move into this next phase of being an increasingly cantankerous, I am sure, old woman, I also want to be able to show that level of fearlessness that I saw in my aunt and in my grandmothers, of just taking life and living it as completely and fully as I can, and being just totally unfuckwithable. Yes, I'm just gonna say that. So that's what I'm taking in. I mean, I don't turn 60 for another couple of years, but I have some time to, like, I'm on the on-ramp. I have some time to get ready for it. So that's what I'm looking to take with me into my next decade. So thank you, everybody.
Oh my God, the unfuckwithable Stacie Evans.
So awesome, Stacie.
Talk about intergenerational matriarchal transitions. Like, fuck yeah.
I love how you're excited to plan to be 60. That's... I want to be you when I grow up.
Excited about getting old. If you get to get old, it means that you succeeded. You survived all the shit. You're still here, and now you get to go and do whatever the fuck you want. So, like, I've been through a lot of shit. I'm still here. Now I get to go do. That's like, we should all be so excited to get old. If you don't get to be old, it's like you got cheated. Like, you didn't get all your time. Like, think of all the stuff you still have to do. You need to get old to be able to do all that stuff.
So, I've got completely changing my outlook on life.
And of course, I'm going to say, obviously, like, we're supposed to be mortified about getting old, but it's probably also easier for me to get old because I'm super vain and I don't look old. And so, like, I can be, like, really casual about, oh, yeah, I'm so old. But like, if I looked as old as I feel some days, I probably wouldn't be sounding all chipper about it. But it's going to be honest.
Well, I'm excited for you to be old because I want to sit by you for all of the times. That's just what I want to do. I want to bring you cookies and dumplings.
Christina says that, and you think that's just like a really cute thing for her to say, but no, Christina has like fed me during the pandemic. She'll just like text me and be like, I made a shit ton of dumplings. You want some? And she'll just come and like bring me food. And yeah, she's a beautiful, lovely human being.
It's how I show love. Shall we move on to showing a little bit of love to our one of the hosts from season one, the first.
Ooh, season two.
Season two?
Yes.
Two. Season one. Oh, yeah. Karen's hosted. All right. Hate Hill Cantrell.
Hello.
Next.
Yeah, that's you. Welcome up. Our beautiful one of two hosts from season two, Kate Hill Cantrell. Kate Hill Cantrell is the author of the short story collection Walk Back from Monkey School. Her writing has appeared in numerous journals, literary magazines, and anthologies. prior to a year of co-hosting the How to Build a Fire series, she curated and hosted Rabbit Tales, a reading and performance series in Dumbo, Brooklyn, that brought many languages of artistic expression together. Presently, she is revisiting her love of the short story by trying to write frequently and freely without a premeditated theme, but in the hopes that the stories can create a collection on their own, which is a beautiful intention for a beautiful person who is about to tell a beautiful story. Welcome, Kate.
Hi, everyone. It's so great to see you. By the way, I have to just say this off the bat. I hate Zoom. Nothing about it works for me. It makes me very nervous, so I'm just pretending right now, okay?
It's not happening, Kate. You're not on Zoom.
Zoom has a terrible attitude. Technology has an attitude.
I know. I'm a Luddite. Terrence will attest to that. But anyway, I can adapt. So hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. It's so great to see the people I knew and to get to know the people I know now. We have, you know, it's very short timing. I'm just going to get into my story and I'm going to keep it very brief. So we were going to talk about elders. So I was going to tell you a funny story about Billy Joe Shaver and Willie Nelson. But now that we're doing transitions, I had to go into the divorce story. So sorry, but it was going to be funny, but this one's not so funny, but that's okay. It's going to be short. I don't know who's talking, but oh, it doesn't matter. So I'm going to try that. This is why I don't like Zoom. I get very distracted. Okay, so I call this year 12. So it's 1984. I am in seventh grade, and I'm being driven to school, I believe, by my mother. I'm not sure if it was my mother because the time in our family at that point was not very consistent. Nothing was really consistent. So year 12, my parents' marriage had been dead for about 6 years, completely dead. They still cohabitated and they still co-parented, but my mother lived on the third floor. My father lived on the second floor. We made, you know, excuses for that, but the fact is it was long gone. So I don't know who was driving me to school at the time. I believe on this day it was my mother, and it was a beautiful October morning, and I remember that very specifically. And we're driving over the McCallum Street Bridge. This is in Philly, if you needed context. Driving over the McCallum Street Bridge, and we see Pop-Up, little Pop-Up. We call him little Pop-Up because he was the skinny one. And he was the runner, the marathoner, and he was out for his either 5K or 10K run. I don't know what it was. But he is wearing his tube socks with the stripes, his Bruce Jenner sneakers. I think he had one of those things on, you know, the head things. And we're like, hi, Pop-Pop. Hi, Pop-Pop. And he goes, hi, girls. I'll see you later after school. And we're like, okay, see you later. Enjoy your run. So it was, you know, very connective and very sweet. I go to school. My sister goes to school. We're, you know, school. And then after school, I am in hockey practice. And I think it was practice. I don't think it was a meet or a match. I think it was just a practice. But I'm still in my uniform, everything. And then I feel my my coach's hand on my back. And she just kind of quietly said, you need to speak to your father. He's coming here. And I just didn't know what she meant. And I look up, this sounds as hoity-toity as it was, the Great Lawn. So it was the Great Lawn, and my father's walking down the Great Lawn, his Brooke Brothers, pink Brooke Brothers shirt, his khaki pants, his Doc Siders, and the look of just forlornness on his face. Is that a word? Forlornness? I think so. I'm going to make it one. And he just looked very, very sad. And the first thing I thought was, this is it. My parents are coming to tell me, or he's coming down to tell me that they're getting divorced. And my heart kind of dropped, but I was a little bit relieved at the same time. And he comes and I put down my hockey stick and I nod to him. I'm like, it's okay, Dad. It's okay. I get it. Like, it's time. And he goes, no, you don't know. And I said, no, it's time. He goes, no, you don't know. And I said, what? And he goes, I need to tell you. Pop-up died. Your grandpa died. And I said, no, wait, what do you mean? Oh, fat grandpa? Big pop-up? He goes, no, little pop-up. And I said, no, he didn't. I just saw him this morning. He was running. I saw him this morning. He goes, yeah, well, after that, he went to the kitchen, had a glass of water, felt dizzy, laid down, died. And I just said to my dad, I'm going to go change out of my hockey uniform and I'll meet you in the parking lot. I can't even explain what I was feeling. I was so in shock. And I was like, why couldn't you have delivered me that other news that I was prepared for? And I was not prepared for this. So the reason why I'm making this into transitions is because, okay, I'm going to take you to the funeral. Go to the funeral. Everyone knows funerals. They are what they are. There's an open casket. My father puts his father's sneakers into, my father's also a marathoner, puts them into the casket and said, what a great way to go, Dad. What a great way to go. Then we bury my grandfather in the ground. And you know that drive away from like the whole service, the whole everything, the whole shebang, the whole, you know, that's the, like, the part where things sink in. So my father, who is, you know, greatest American hero kind of guy, he's in the front seat with my mother, who he's essentially completely estranged from. I must have been in the middle of my two sisters because I saw everything. We're driving away from the cemetery, and my father does this kind of like a man cry. It's like a choke laugh, and like kind of, you know, like he didn't know how to express it. And my mother, I had not seen them touch for at least 6 years. Not a hug, not a kiss, not a gesture, nothing. And when he did that, I saw my mother look at him with incredibly kind, empathetic, endearing eyes. And she touched him just for a moment on his knee. And then she took it away. But the look that they had, or the look that she gave to him while he was having that man choke cry, was so astounding to me that 6 months later, when they announced their divorce over a spaghetti dinner, and, you know, I love spaghetti, and it's amazing that I left it there, but I said, take me to Lizzie Minton's. I can't be here tonight. My father drove me there. Lizzie Minton and I listened to the Smiths, and we stared out our window, and we microwaved bacon because I ate bacon then, but only at Lizzie's house. And I just looked out the window and I said, that's a bear in that field. She was in the suburbs. And I said, that's a bear. She goes, no, it's a hay barrel. And I said, it's a bear. She goes, okay. It was a bear. But the thing is, 6 months later, I mean, that time later, when my parents did say that they were getting divorced, what got me through it was that memory, that I was not born out of hatred. I was born out of love, and they had a connection. And I saw it for real at that moment when it was important. And I held on to that, well, obviously, till today. So, you know, it makes a huge difference for me to know that, I mean, thank God that my parents did split, because it was time, and it wasn't easy, and there were many transitions. I went from an 8-bedroom house to a 1 one-bedroom apartment in downtown Philadelphia, where not only did I not have my own room, I had to sleep in the room with my sister, and I had to share a bed with my mother. Everything was different. Transitions, you can't even start with them, but I'm not going to go on with those. I just want to say the most important thing was that touch and that look, and just to know that I was born of love, and that was very good for me. So that's it. Thank you.
Beautiful.
Thank you, Kate.
Thank you.
Be born of love is an amazing thing to hold on to. I think that's worth holding on to for as long as you can.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
But once you know it, it's forever.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, so we are going to move on to Dennis Norris II, my beloved Dennis.
Also a co-host for season two.
Yes.
So Kate, so as Stacie, for those of you who are not hosts, and for those of you who are, you know, just familiarizing, every season has had co-hosts. Kate and Dennis hosted together.
And the whole time,
I like the semaphore
the entire time, I thought I was as tall as he was, or at least as tall. And then I see pictures.
No. No. Plus, Dennis wore like shoes that got them higher.
Yeah, so did I.
That's true.
So, I'm gonna read the bio that Dennis prepared, as opposed to the one that is running in my head right now. Dennis Norris II is the recipient of fellowships from the McDowell Colony, Tin House, VCCA, and the Cambilio Center for African American Fiction. Their work appears or is forthcoming in McSweeney's, American Short Fiction, The Cut, Zora, Smoke Bomb Quarterly, and elsewhere. They currently serve as senior fiction editor at The Rumpus and co-host of the critically acclaimed podcast, Food for Thought. They hosted How to Build a Fire in its second season. And everyone, please welcome the child I never had, Dennis Norris.
Hi, everyone. It is amazing.
Let me spotlight you, Dennis.
Oh, yes.
There you go. Yes, you're good.
Fabulous to be back. It feels like I'm coming home. Yay. I sort of feel like, when I started hosting How to Build a Fire, it was at the start of like my third year, I think, living in New York. And I was feeling like I was beginning to hit my stride. And Terry, who was my neighbor, we lived in neighboring buildings, asked me to do this. And I just sort of felt like, oh, I'm like becoming a person who's like doing okay in New York, because like I have a job and I am like pursuing, I have an artistic pursuit, and now I'm doing this thing that's like, has me speaking in front of people publicly. So it was like, yes, Dennis, you've like made the right decision. You didn't supremely screw up by moving to this wretched city. So anyway, it's great to be back and I love you all. And yes, Stacie, truly, like if my mother hadn't been my mother, Stacie, I think would have been. So always love seeing you and so glad you've been hosting this year. I'm gonna try also and keep it relatively quick. So I'm just gonna go into it. I started graduate school in the fall of 2010. I went to Sarah Lawrence. I was pursuing an MFA in creative writing. And it really felt like this incredibly special thing, because I went to a wonderful college that was my top choice college, this place called Haverford, that's in the suburbs of Philadelphia. But before I discovered Haverford when I was in high school, I really wanted to go to Sarah Lawrence. They had this, after I took the PSATs, I got pamphlets from lots of colleges, and Sarah Lawrence sent me one, and on the cover it said, "You were different, so were we." And like every other queer kid in the United States in 2002, I was like, oh my God, I am different. Like, and the thing, I didn't know that I was going to pursue a career as a writer at the time, but I knew I wanted to be a writer. And I knew I wanted to write, like not as a career, but I just, it was something I wanted to do and enjoyed doing. And really, I thought it was the only thing that I was good at sort of like in school. And I had gone to this like really sort of elite and wealthy all boys private school called University School in a place called Hunting Valley, Ohio, if that gives you any sense of their sensibility. And if you want a couple more details, one of my friends was a state golfing champion whose name was Putter. And another one of my classmates was a kid who went to school an hour away. And before he was old enough to get his learner's permit, his parents bought him a brand new Lexus and hired a driver to drive him to and from the school. So that's, like, I was not any of those things. Like, I was not rich like that. But my parents were able to put together the money for me to go along with some scholarships. And so I went. And I was very much out of place. I, in some ways, was behind academically. I was queer, but, you know, I didn't know it quite yet when I was a freshman. I didn't understand what that meant. And I was not athletic, really, you know, in the ways that they wanted, that I, that would have benefited me there. So it was a really tough place for me to be. And so I really wanted to go to a very different kind of place. Anyway, my parents, we visited Sarah Lawrence. I loved it because you could study writing there in a very serious way. I loved it. They didn't do tests. And my parent, my father, who was a Baptist minister, was like, absolutely not. This place is too free and you're not going there. And I sort of thought I was screwed because I didn't think I would get into Haverford, and I just sort of didn't know what I was going to do. I did get into Sarah Lawrence. I did get into Haverford. I went to Haverford, had a great time, made the best friends in the world, and that was great. But then I applied to graduate schools for creative writing, and I got into Sarah Lawrence, and there were many, many places that I didn't get into, and I kind of was like, I have to go here. And I called my dad, and I was like, well, I think I'm going to go there. And he was like fine with it, and also I was an adult and he wasn't paying, but he grumbled a little bit. Like, he was like, that crazy place. So anyway, I get to Sarah Lawrence. Part of the way that I'm financing my education there is that I had been an RA in college. They had a different name for it at Haverford, but I had been an RA. And so they had one opening. They had three positions on campus, but two of them were already filled, and only one was open for that upcoming school year for something called a graduate hall director, which meant that you lived in a dorm for free. You got a $2,000 stipend every semester. You got a meal plan that I think covered one full meal a day and some snacks or something. So it wasn't a full meal plan, but it was helpful. And I applied for that job and got that job, which was great because otherwise I would have been taking out huge amounts of loans to go there. And so I think it's just important to know that I was living in this dorm. So I'm in my first month of graduate school. I'm like adjusting to life, you know, in a dorm. It feels like I'd been away from school forever, even though it had only been 2 years. And the weekend of Halloween arrives, and a big part of my job that gave me this on-campus housing was that one night a week and one weekend a month, I would be what was called on call. And that meant that I had a special phone. And if there was any trouble on campus with students, then I was the first person to be called. So like if a student needed to go to the hospital, typically I went with them. If there was some kind of fight or disciplinary incident, I was like the first person to show up on the scene and offer support. And so my friend who had the job was like, I would really love to switch with you for this weekend because my boyfriend has tickets for something. So would you, can we switch weekends? And so I was like, yeah, let's switch. It's fine. I think I had a short story due the next week for class. So I was like, I'll just be in my room all weekend writing anyway. So we switched and I was on call and I was nervous about it because everyone was like, oh, it's Sarah Lawrence. Halloween's a big party weekend. Like, you'll probably have 3 or 4 trips to the hospital each night. Like, just be prepared. So the first night I had no trips to the hospital, which I was pretty surprised about, but it was a relief. And then the second night came and I was in my room and I was writing. I had been writing all day. I was just having a great writing session with this one short story that I had been kind of stuck on. It was like really coming through. And so I just kind of wrote and wrote and wrote and wrote. And I was like, oh, maybe this story will be good after all. I had like found a different voice. I'd changed the point of view, all these technical things. And then it was like coming. And then I got a call from my sister around, I think 9 or 10 p.m. And she told me that my dad was being rushed to the hospital. He had passed out at the dining room table where he was writing a sermon. He had retired as a minister, but was sort of filling in at this one church. And so he was writing a sermon. Now, the context is that earlier that year, I think in February, my dad had had open heart surgery to have a valve replaced. He was a really, really healthy person. So that surgery went very well. He recovered in, I think, half the time that they had expected or half the time that is normal for that and done really well. But he needed to have some kind of additional simple outpatient procedure. That procedure had a very small chance of causing like blood clots that could then travel up to your brain. And so we later learned that that's what had happened. So my dad passes out and I just sort of knew that he wasn't going to survive this. I don't know how I knew it, but he had had some health issues the previous year, and my mom had had health issues 2 years before. My parents were a lot older when they had me, so like them having health issues was a part of my growing up because they were like 41 and 50 when I was born. And so I just sort of knew inside my bones that this was it. And so my sister and I stayed in contact for several hours, and around 3 or 4 in the morning, she was like, okay, you should come home. And so I like went online, I bought a plane ticket, took a cab all the way from Sarah Lawrence to Newark Airport, which was very expensive. Very expensive. But these were the days before Lyft and Uber. I don't know that that would have been cheaper, but anyway. And I handed in my phone so someone else could be on call for the rest of the weekend and went home. And when I got to Cleveland, I remember getting to my dad's hospital room in the afternoon, like maybe 5 or so. And I was the last of my siblings to arrive. I have 3 siblings. And I was the last one to get there. And a doctor walked in and immediately was like, okay, so now that we're all here, now that you're all here, like we should start talking about, you know, pulling the plug. And it was just this like sort of like chalk on the blackboard moment, because it was like, we're not ready to have that conversation. I just got here. You know, and so my father lived for a week in a coma, and we were getting ready to start having conversations about pulling the plug. My family is a very religious family. There was a lot of prayer. There was a lot of hope. I felt none of that because I just somehow felt like I knew how this was going to turn out. But I went along with all of it because I'm the youngest and because it's what you do, I think, in these kinds of moments. And so he ended up passing away naturally, and we didn't even have to pull the plug on the life support, which was, I think, a relief for myself and my mom and my sisters. This was, at this point, it was early November. So I stayed in Cleveland for the next few weeks while we planned the funeral and all that. And then I went back to school in... right after Thanksgiving, so like basically December. And throughout the rest of that year. And I didn't connect this until that situation, until recently. I really, really struggled with my writing. I was able to write a lot, and by all accounts, my professors and my evaluations and the feedback I would get in my classes, I was writing very well. But I wasn't writing anything that really mattered to me. And I didn't know how to figure out how to do that. But I felt as though my work was not serious. I think I was writing about serious topics. I think people took the work seriously, but like it wasn't serious to me. And I didn't know how to figure that out. A classmate of mine just sort of mentioned this writing workshop for writers of color that I had never heard of before called Vona, and how she was really hoping to get to work with a particular teacher there. And I thought, oh my gosh, I need to go to that space. And so I applied to Vona and I got in, and long story short, that's how I met Stacie. We met at Vona that summer and fell in love.
yes,
it's true.
I also ended up working with a teacher who took one look at a short story of mine, sat me down in our one-on-one, and said, "Well," she said, "this is a good story. It's very well written. I think it's publishable," but she was like, "You are in the closet on the page," and I thought, "What? Like, I've been out since I was 15. I like." Tell people that I came out of the womb out, like no one ever thought I was straight. Like, what are you talking about? But I realized that I had been writing this work that, like, I would sometimes write stories about gay people, and I would sometimes write stories about Black people, but I would also write stories about rich white people and straight people. And I realized that that was not what I wanted to do. And so it was in that week that I started working on a short story that was very close to my life in a number of ways. And it's that short story that became a novel that is this novel that I'm, you know, actually very soon gonna be handing in to send out to publishers, and parts of it have been published, and we're moving forward. But in the writing of that piece, I began to find like what I wanted to do with my life. Like, I knew I wanted to be a writer, but I didn't know what I wanted to do with it or why I wanted to write. I just knew that I liked it and that people said that I was good at it. And I realized that there were stories from people like me, people who looked like me, people who had childhoods like me, people who loved like me, that needed to be told and that really weren't being told. And there's this bit of advice that I feel like you often hear when you're sort of in the process of pursuing writing in a serious way. And you hear it, I think, early on, and it's about telling the stories that only you can tell. But it's this thing that, like, for a long time, I didn't understand what that meant. And it wasn't until I lived a little bit went through all of this that I began to figure it out and began to understand. And when I started writing this book that I'm like so deep in right now, you know, it deals with a young gay Black man living in New York in the wake of his father's death. So there are like some very obvious connections there. But I felt as though I was like, oh, this is something that I'm writing, that this is the first thing that I've written, I think, that only I could write, and that I could write in this way. And so that is basically the story. The other thing I would just say is that all of that is like when I grew up. Like, I was the youngest of four kids, really, really spoiled. And because my siblings were a lot older than me, like, they were very involved in everything. So like at that point, I really didn't know how to make a decision without consulting, like, bringing together the whole council of Norrises on a conference call, and like usually listening to everyone else and thinking they're older than me, they're smarter than me, like, you know, they know best. And it was at that point in my life, and then moving to New York, where I just began to be like, oh no, like I can maneuver my life myself. I can make decisions, and I can like move forward, and I can stand behind them and feel okay about that. And if they're the wrong decisions, then I can handle them. And if they're the right decisions, then, you know, there we go. So yeah, I think that's my entry for tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis.
Oh, thank you.
Beautiful. Some of this.
Oh my God. I love you so much.
When Dennis said that we used to meet in the backyard, in the courtyard, I was very afraid he was going to start telling some of those stories. And I was like, oh, no.
Oh, they're good stories. They're good stories. But no, Terry, that's for my memoir.
Dennis, that's the same way that Terrence invited me, is that we were neighbors. And he was like, ooh, you look interesting. Come, do this thing. And I was like, yes, thank God. I've made it in New York. Exactly the same.
That's like, how it feels.
Terrence, like the grandpa gateway of like,
oh, yeah, there it is. There it is.
Always at least once a month, we have to call you. I always call you Uncle Terrence, not grandpa.
Yeah, but you're to be my grandpa. I'm almost 30. Don't be grandpa to me.
It doesn't make it less creepy, you guys.
No, but it's very, he has an eye for people, right? And he just spots them.
Mm-hmm.
He's like you. The first time he invited me to tell a story, I will say, the week of, I was so nervous and freaking out that literally, I think up until the day of, I was about to text him and be like, I can't do it. I was like, okay, if I tell him I'm sick, and then if he sees me, I'm gonna have to act sick. Like, I have to like stand behind this lie. And then finally I was like, just do it. Like, just do it. And then I ended up telling this really fun, slutty story that I stole.
Oh, heels to Jesus. That was how I learned about heels to Jesus.
Heels to Jesus.
Also, fun fact, Dennis is the first host that said, there can't be any more hosts. I am the host from now on. There are no more hosts. And I was like, no, I've already got them picked out. He's like, well, you're going to have to tell them now.
Christina and I tried that too. We were like, oh, you just meant that we were going to be the hosts from now on forever, right? Like,
yeah.
I feel Terrence like, is like, I oh, we already like, chose the next two hosts.
Terrence, you were the host for the first season, and Dennis was the first host that you invited. So every host subsequent from you, Terrence, has said, oh no, it's me from now on.
I had some quit. I had host quit. Here. I had some host quit.
I was a replacement.
Speaking of Reese, hello.
Oh, what a great transition.
Hi, Reese. Thank you. Let's have a little show of love for Kate and Dennis, hosts from the second season.
Yay.
Thank you.
That was the season when I told the story of How to Build a Fire. That was how I found out about How to Build a Fire.
Beautiful. And moving on to season 3 that Matt hosted somewhere down there, and Reese as well. Matt, give us a wave.
Where is Matt?
I don't know. He was here.
He's just has an M on him.
He's the big M.
He's eating. He doesn't want us to see him eating.
It stands for making out. Making out.
Well, that's cute. I'm
no, what eating. Eating are you talking about?
Hungry eating.
We were making out. Sorry, did you just say you're eating each other out?
Oh,
family show, Chrissy.
I was just repeating what I heard.
You hear what you want to hear.
That's quite an achievement if you were. I'm not going to
okay, I will say I'm not sure my mom knows what that means, so it's okay. Carry on.
My mom's here, and it looks like she dropped her phone on that one. Really quick note. Matt is in his first week of Zoom classes with junior high students, so he's not telling a story tonight. He is recovering from his first week back in school where they're doing remote
it's
learning.
So good that Terrence
let's give Matt a round of applause.
That's true.
Let's give Matt a round of applause.
Christina and I are still convinced that Matt is telling a story, but that's okay.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that Matt is scheduled in for the first after the break. So I'll Terrence, we'll talk to Matt about that. Thank you for chiming in.
All right, all right.
Emily Ray
now,
Reese.
It's time for Reese.
I would love to introduce Race. Emily Ray Race is a social change-driven artist who takes socially and culturally minded approach to her filmmaking and storytelling. She tells stories that examine identity within underrepresented rural and economically impoverished communities. Her work comes from a deeply personal place, often explores queerness, socioeconomic hardships, and New Mexican culture and communities. Visually, she works to create the whimsical magic she found as a child playing alone in the vast wilderness, while also addressing the dark realities of poverty, addiction, abuse, betrayal, and death. She was raised by hunters, surrounded by death and the survival of only the fittest. The people of her childhood struggled with the deep desire to hold on to the past, while she grew to understand her queer identity, fear a lack of acceptance, and dream of escape. The world and these experiences continue to inspire the stories she tells and how she tells them. Her filmmaking will continue to focus on telling the often unseen stories of people living in rural America, not depicted as other, but rather from an insider perspective. Emily Ray Reese, everybody, welcome.
Hi.
Quick note on Reese. Reese is the first person that actually successfully said, "My season's not over, it continues."
Well, I was...
It's fair. We don't.
It was just a replacement, you know? I had only gotten a taste of it all at that point. I have to say that was like deeply hard to have you read about me to me. I don't think I've ever had that happen before. It is brutal.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, I'm like a little...
I love you, and it's okay.
I got to host two seasons, so take that, everyone, sort of.
No, I'm insanely jealous of you already.
I mean, I hosted like a season and a half because I was the tag in like wrestling. Is that what you call it?
Yeah, yeah. Tag team wrestling. You got it.
Yeah, I was the tag team. I hosted with Matt, and we are the same size. Every picture, it's like very obvious how sized and shaped we are. All right, so transitions. I think a lot of what I'm going to talk about is strangely similar to some of these other things we've heard. I've had a really rough week. My heart was pulled out of my chest and ripped into 1,000 pieces. So I'm just gonna go with it. That's where I'm at. I'm gonna talk about probably the first transition that I really had to grapple with as a person. I was 13 years old. It was the summer before I went into eighth grade. And I don't know about you guys, but like those middle school years were just really brutal for me. I am a late bloomer, always have been, always will be, I think. And at that age, being a late bloomer is the most unpopular thing you could possibly be. I already just was like a super insecure kid. Just already like not ready for like life stuff to hit me. But that summer my mother sent me to Ohio. Where are you, Dennis? Yeah, I was up in your world. Because my mom grew up in Toledo, Ohio, and that's where her whole family still is. And she sent me up to to Toledo to like stay with my grandparents for like a month or something. And it was my first time traveling alone. It was my first time going to Ohio alone. And I think, it gave me this impression I was like a big kid or something at that point. So I traveled on the airplane alone. And back then, they sort of gave you like the flight attendant, like sort of ushered you, but they weren't really making sure you weren't like abandoned or kidnapped or anything. And when I got back to Albuquerque, which is, it's about 3 hours from where I grew up, but it's the closest airport. When I got back to Albuquerque and I got off the plane, no one was there to pick me up. And from what I had understood, my dad was supposed to be picking me up because I guess he was had a hunting trip and he was gonna like come through Albuquerque and pick me up. And so the fact that nobody was there wasn't a big surprise for me because my dad was never good at being at the right place at the right time, especially when picking up his kids. I wandered down to the like place where you get your luggage, the baggage area. And Albuquerque Airport is like the smallest airport of any airport that's ever been built, I'm pretty sure. It has one terminal and you walk down an like tiny corridor and then you go down these escalator and you're in the baggage place. So I get down there and I'm waiting for my mom and my brother's 8 years younger than me. And so I was 13, my brother was like, what is that, five? Who knows math? I also teach on Zoom, which is qualifying for me, but it is not math. It's filmmaking, which is really quite a challenge. Anyway, so my brother, he's the little five-year-old guy, comes up behind me and like grabs me and squeezes me. And I turn around and he like looks up at me and he says, "Mom and Dad are getting a divorce." And I don't think my brother understood what that meant, right? But I did. And so I look up and I see my mom walking towards me and a little bit like deer in headlights. So I'm like, what? What is Jimmy talking about? And my mom was like, we'll talk about it later. My mom is very much a like, we'll talk about it later kind of person. So we get my stuff and we get in my mom drove this really old Suburban from the 70s, like one of those long ones that only has three doors. Only one side has that second door and the floor is rusted out on like in front of where we sat so I could like watch the road go by. And it definitely didn't go above 50 miles per hour. If it went above 50 miles per hour, it'd start shaking to the point where you felt like it was gonna fall apart. So we get in the Suburban and like it is packed to the brim with stuff. Like, and not packed, it's just like trash bags of stuff. It looks like my mom packed up our lives in about 30 minutes. And it is all in the back of the Suburban. So at that point, I know it's real. I know that something has happened. So we drive back, but we don't drive back to the trailer I grew up in. We drive to my mom's friend's house that's like down this canyon in this little town called Ute Park. It's not even really a town. It's just this like little hub of houses that are up in the mountains. And my mom takes us to her friend's house and no one's there. It's just us. And then my mom comes out with it that she left my dad when he went on a hunting trip. She packed up all her stuff and we are hiding. We are hiding at this house until my mom can figure out where we're gonna go. And so I asked my mom why we're hiding. And my mom tries to delicately explain that she's afraid of my dad. and of what he's going to do when he realizes what's happened. So we stay up in this like tiny little house in the mountains for about a month while my mom is like trying to figure out where we're going to go. My mom found this like little adobe shack to rent in this. So I'll just give you a little geography really quickly. In northern New Mexico, there's Taos, which is the town that most people have heard of. Taos is this like really amazing sort of artist community, also very flawed place, but also very magical. And there's a circle of towns that sort of connect to Taos. So in the middle of all those towns is Wheeler Peak, which is the highest mountain in New Mexico. So Taos is sort of on one side. And then if you literally cross over the mountain, you hit the ghost town that I grew up in. So from Taos, there's a town between, there's a couple towns between where I grew up. So one is Cuesta and then Red River and then Eagle Nest and then Angel Fire and then Taos. And literally it's like a circle of, it gets wider as you go. So Taos is like very Latino. It's getting wider now, but it's getting more mixed now. But then Cuesta is extremely Latino. And then Red River is a little wider and Eagle Nest is very white and Angel Fire is all white. And then we got back to Taos. So it's like this weird world, but they're all connected. And my mom found this little adobe shack in outside of Cuesta for us to live in. And so she takes us there and I have neighbors for the first time. I grew up in this like ghost town where I had no neighbors. I was the only kid except for my little brother. And now there's like all these boys who live next door and another girl who lives across the street. And I'm like the only white kid around. And I got barked at literally, which was an interesting experience, but that's not what this story is about. But it was like quite a shock to the system. I still loved my dad. You know, I was never unaware of his flaws. My parents were not hiders of things. They don't talk about things, but they didn't hide things. Like my parents sold drugs. I knew my whole life. My dad had many affairs. I knew my whole life. They're these like weird, I don't know, rebels, that didn't hide who they were. They just drugged me along with them. So I was mad at my dad, and I knew why, but I still wanted to see him. So I kept asking my mom if I could see my dad. So about 3 months after my mom left my dad, she decided that she would let me see my dad. So she dropped me and my brother off at the highway that by my dad's, like by the trailer I grew up in. But I had to walk, it's like a 10-minute walk from the highway. So my mom just dropped us off and left. So I walked my little brother up this road, up the dirt road to my dad's trailer. And when I got there, it literally felt like a ghost town. Like there was like just nothing happening. It was just like so quiet. And I just went in. I opened the trailer door and I went in, and our dog Buddy, who my dad had with him when he went on this hunting trip, just like barreled out of my dad's room and just like jumped all over us. And so we were just really excited to see Buddy. He was this big chocolate lab that we'd gotten for Christmas. And I don't know, he was just like one of those dogs who's also your sibling. And my dad sort of wandered out of his room, and I remember just like looking up at my dad, and my dad is this huge mountain man hunter. Like he takes people bear and mountain lion hunting for a living. He is the epitome of masculinity. You know, he is like that his name is Zeus. Like that is, I don't know if the name came first or the personality, but he embodies it 100%. So my dad came out of the room, and I've never seen my dad look so small and frail and just broken. And my dad saw us and just was bawling, like, uncontrollably. And for me to see, like, my dad, like, the strongest person I've ever known in my life, to just be broken, it really destroyed me. And I couldn't really handle it. So I went and sat on the couch, and I looked outside the window trying to sort of escape the situation. And I saw my dad's truck, and it was just, like, you know, covered in dirt. But in the dirt, on the window, my dad had wrote, "Help me." Mm-hmm. And it was like, I felt like it was a calling to me to help him. And I've never felt so helpless. Like, there was nothing I could do. And my dad, he begged me to tell him where we were and where my mom was. And my mom had begged me to not to tell him anything before I left. So I was really stuck between them, not knowing if I, like, who to honor. Like, do I tell my dad, or do I do what my mom asked and not tell my dad? And I was very frozen, and I didn't know the right thing to do. And I didn't tell my dad. I decided that my mom needed to tell my dad. And so that's the decision I made, and that's what I said. You need to ask mom. But despite the fact that I tried to, like, create a boundary in that moment, that boundary has never been respected by my parents. I have forever, since that, I became the communication between my parents. I am the person who sends the messages, and I have been since then, and I continue to be. And I realized that this, like, got put on me as a kid, and it's never gone away. And not just with my parents, it's now, like, a thing I put on myself. I put myself in charge of things in my life that I shouldn't be in charge of. And it's like it's a pattern that I am aware of and have not been able to dismantle, and I'm still grappling with. And I guess for me, like, my big goal in transitions from here on out in my life is that they don't create a negative pattern in my life that I can't stop repeating. And I fear that with this experience of this pandemic, of, like, this transition into isolation and into like onlineness. I teach all my classes now online. Most of my social life is online. And I fear that this is going to create these patterns in not just me, but in us as people, of a fear of intimacy, a fear of gathering as a community, a fear of of being in someone else's space, a fear of touching. And I don't know how not to have that happen, but my experience of, like, my parents, of the transition from my parents being together to not being together, like, I don't want to repeat that, that not being able to escape the positions we're put in, and then having to, like, somehow try and dismantle it as later on in life, and it being so ingrained that it's really hard to operate outside of those. So I just hope that we can all stay conscious of, like, not letting this moment negatively affect our futures. That's where I'm at.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Reese, for sharing.
Wow.
Every part of that, and every part of the insight that you garnered from it. And I really appreciated your bio, because I felt like I understood where you were coming from in a more intimate way. the setting of your processing and understanding your space is really beautiful and very brave.
Yeah, that was powerful. I share a lot of those fears about what all of this is going to mean for how we interact with one another moving forward. And how do we fight against that? Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, but I hope we do.
I hope we do.
I think we will. I think we will share space again. And I think we will, you know, be aware of the patterns that are created in these moments of great contraction, which is, you know, the awareness is the first place to call. And after that, we have to grow. But
yeah, Christina doesn't know it, but whenever she decides that she's going to come back to New York City, because she's not here right now.
It's like, okay, so I've been on the West Coast for like a month.
Forever.
And a half.
7 months. 7 months. It's been
just
7 months.
Forever.
Has it been 10 years? No.
When she comes back to New York, I fully intend to make her part of my pod because I just can't keep going without hugging people. I haven't touched a person since March 8th. That is way too long. So,
Stacie,
yeah.
Stacie, I am your
already in advance. Yes.
I'm here. Yes.
And on that, you know, lovely TMI note, we're going to take a break.
And I'm going to play some music.
All right. Terrence is going to play some tunes. Go and get some water in.
I'm going to go get a snack and
do the thing.
I'm going to pause the recording while we're on a break so that we don't have to worry about musical copyrights and things like that.
If anybody has Philip's number.
Love that you're around. If you're not, just if you can hear us, that would be awesome. But we are going to get rolling very soon. By very soon, I mean now. Welcome back. I hope you danced. There was some wonderful dancing. I was eating teriyaki. It was good.
So,
shall we
don't have Phil.
No.
Phil, no Matt.
Phil, I knew that Phil isn't here.
You know what that means time. It's time for, right? That means it's time for us to introduce the creator of How to Build a Fire.
The progenitor.
The only, not our grandfather.
Not our uncle.
Not our uncle.
But everybody's neighbor.
Apparently.
Apparently. I mean, you're my neighbor too, just a little further away. Just another block.
Terrence, Stegman, can you give us a big wave, just in case anybody here doesn't know who you are already? Because we love you, and the 6 seasons going into the 7th season of How to Build a Fire would not have existed without you. So thank you for being an amazing human being and for inviting me and Stacie and Kate and Dennis and Phil and Matt and Reese and all
Elena and Karen.
And Elena. And Karen, and coming up,
and Shafina.
And coming up, Jackie and Lily to host How to Build a Fire, because those invites are what make these things roll.
Yeah, so, that's true. But I think, Terrence, that it's actually time for you to tell a story.
I'm gonna read Terrence's bio.
That's a great idea.
Terrence Degnan has published 2 full-length books of poetry. He's a co-director at the Camperdown organization, which was created to increase access to publication and education, as well as promote agency for underrepresented writers. He lives in Brooklyn with his wife and daughter as an incredible neighbor to me. And a custodian of cucumbers and peppers and tomatoes. Terrence Degnan.
Did you say tomatoes?
I said tomatoes.
I don't even know what those are.
You're gonna have to call the whole thing off.
Hey Matt, unmute yourself so you can help fill in a little bit of the of a bit of the story.
I really have no idea what story you are gonna be telling.
I know.
To making it better.
So it was Reese that taught me that every good story has a beginning and a middle and an end. And it's a good note for anybody that's here tonight that wants to tell a story in the future. So really quickly, the beginning of the story is going to be about my favorite reading that I ever did. The middle is going to be about an anarchist takeover and James Frey, the author. And the ending is going to be about the end of Occupy Wall Street. So that's, hopefully I can get to all those pieces in less than 10 minutes. But the reading that I had was, so everybody needs to know who this guy James Frey is. He was a famous author in the 2000, early 2000s called? What was that called? The aughts? Anyway.
The early aughts.
And he wrote
called the noughties.
He wrote the naughty 90s.
The 90s is the 90s. The noughties is the noughties.
All right. Anyways, there's this guy named James Frey. He got on Oprah's shit list for lying about stuff in his memoir.
Come on.
Anyways, James Frey enters this story at some point. But there was a guy that worked at a place that I worked called, and that Kate worked at, who's here, and Christina worked at, called Rabbit Movers. And I ended up working there for a long time. And going back there at some point. But at one point there was this guy, what was that, the guy's name, Matt, that ran the reading?
Jared
Shanahan. And I had this reading in the Lower East Side, and Jared was a very important part of this story. He ended up being a manager at Rabbit Movers, and he was a self-pronounced anarchist philosopher, and the way that you knew that is because he was constantly quoting books from anarchists or philosophers and interjecting them into conversations. You guys have met people like that before. It's never okay. And it wasn't like he was doing it as like a loving way. I can still hear Prince in my ears, by the way. Prince is still playing in my background. Anyway, so Jared did this reading, and I was invited to it, and Matt and I did it together, and Matt and I put together a fake literary magazine that I would submit to, and then, Matt, why don't you tell this part of the story?
So, basically, he would send me poems, and I would write him back from Zoological Literary Magazine out of Northwestern Idaho State University, run by a motley crew of MFA candidates who all hated each other and their advisor, and who would reject him not about his poem, but about like who he was as a person. So the rejection letters were like, we're not publishing you because you're a bad person for this reason, this reason, this reason. And when we read this out loud, we read it as if it was like a real thing. And I was just his friend helping him out with this reading.
So this is the scene. This guy named Jared is doing a monthly show, a reading, and he says, hey, why don't you come read some poems at this thing? I call up Matt, and I say, hey, well, let's just read the rejection. And this ends up being the best reading. Like, this is over 10 years ago. It's the best reading of my life from my whole life. Like, this is still the best reading that I've ever had. So what would happen was I would read a poem, and I started off with the shortest poems that ever got rejected. And it was the longest poems. And then it ended up being the shortest. And the juxtaposition was, at this reading, it started off like I was just reading poetry, but then the rejection letters got more and more and more hype as it went on. And people really got and we were the last gig of the night. So why don't you talk a little bit more about how the reading went?
So you read like a poem, and I'd read the first rejection letter, and then you read a poem, I'd read the second one, and people were starting to think like, these rejection letters were really weird. Then you read poem, and then the third rejection letter was 15 pages long. and people still thought it was real.
Yeah, so
the reading ended, a guy came up to you, not me, And it was like, I can't believe he was saying all these terrible things about New York City and about you. I can't, like, these people should be out of business. They're ridiculous. Oh, and like he was like really legitimately upset about this.
So it was 20 minutes. So it was a 20 minute slot. And what started off as people being okay with these poems, people started to like get in my camp. And they started to get really upset with these rejection letters, which they believe were completely true. And we got into the 20 minute spot, but we were 3 rejection letters and we had 3 rejection letters to go. And the last one was incredibly long and the whole audience was 100% for it. Anyways, this anarchist guy, that was like how I knew this anarchist philosopher guy who ended up being a manager at the company that I work for. And I was the initial field manager for this moving company. And then a couple of other people subsequently took over that position. And this is before I ended up running the place. But one of the things about that, his time as a field manager at Rabbit Movers was that there was this idea that there would be a socialist anarchist takeover of this company. And it really, like, it was not quiet. It was very public. They were trying to pretend like it was private, but it wasn't. And the thing about these kids, and they were kids to me at the time because I was in my 30s, they were in their 20s. And the thing about these kids is that they were really disorganized in the way that we're going to take over this moving company. And so the old owner called me up and he's like, look, I'm about to lose my company to these anarchists who don't know what the fuck they're doing. And I'm not against socialism, but I think that it's just, and so I ended up being like this mediator. And I started to talk to these kids about how I'm pro-socialist and this is a great idea, but that they're way beyond their depths. And so one of the things I said was, so what's your business model if you're going to be having this takeover? And they didn't have one. And I was like, how are you going to advertise yourselves? Are you going to do that? And it ended up being like this very contentious affair online. And what was funny about this whole online affair was that the guys that were trying to run this takeover, they kept all of the information, all the back and forth, and then they published it as a socialist anarchist manifesto at one point. But they didn't do it. The author of the manifesto was James Frey, the author. So they ended up starting to publish this manifesto in this author's name. And raise your hand in the list of people here if you guys know who James Frey is. So anyways, he was, you know, wrote this book called A Million Little Pieces. And I was like really surprised that this famous author would get involved in such a weird communist takeover of this small moving company in Brooklyn, New York. And so was my wife, Melanie, who's here tonight. She had went about this a really funny way and just directly contacted James Frey. And she was like, well, what the fuck is going on, man? Why are you like getting involved in this weird manifesto? And then what was really weird about this is that then I started having these direct conversations with James Frey, the author. And they were just like ghostwriting in his name. But there was all these back and forth between me and James Frey about the fact that he was being used as this ghostwriter. And so like we went from this reading that this guy put together to the takeover of this company that I was in by this guy that ran the reading, to James Frey being this fake author of this communist manifesto, to then Occupy Wall Street. And I did a reading with the same guy at Occupy Wall Street. And, you know, at one point during this time, you know, I was part of the Occupy Wall Street movement at the library. If you were in part of that movement, and Kate actually did a reading with us as well. And this guy put on this reading, Jared. And one of the things that I did was help put together this anthology of poets, because there was like hundreds of poems that would come in to this anthology every month. And we were trying to keep it all together. Like Patti Smith sent in a poem and a bunch of other pretty well-known writers. And we've tried to keep it as socialist as possible. So it was just, we were publishing it as it went along. But anyways, this guy, Jared, put on this reading. And it was beautiful. I mean, Kate told a story about the police and how there's many sides of a book, and that you know, at the time we knew that we were going to be taken over by the cops at some point, because it was not secure. And you know, Zuccotti Park every night was getting a little bit more dangerous. But anyways, this guy put on this reading, and again, it was that he, you know, quoted a lot of famous philosophers and anarchists. And it was weird because he kept on coming into my life, this kid Jared, and I started to realize that he wasn't safe, that he wasn't secure, that his mind was in another place. And I felt bad because I had gone through this whole, and I had successfully stopped them from taking over this company because I knew that it was going to go belly up if they took it over. And so I had some residual guilt over that experience. And I'm getting to the end of Occupy Wall Street, which is kind of like the crux of this whole thing, was when Occupy Wall Street was taken over, we watched it from our TVs. If anybody watched what happened during Occupy, not only did they brought in sound cannons, you know about that, they brought in like these loud sound cannons at 3 o'clock in the morning, but then they were pushing a bunch of people, and I believe that this was the march that this kid Jared was in at the end. It could be a different march, but I'm pretty sure it was either this or one of the very first Black Lives Matter marches. But I can remember very specifically watching it from the helicopter's perspective. So there was police helicopters that were watching this march, and you know, a bunch of you guys know me throughout the years. I've been in a lot of marches with a lot of the people that are on these screens. Christina and I have been to marches together. Kate and I have gone to things together. You know, like a lot of the people that are even in, you know, Matt and I have been to things, and Andrew and I have been to things, and I knew this one was a little different, and I knew this one was really dangerous. And I remember watching from this helicopter, knowing that, you know, this kid Jared was probably there, and it was either at Black Lives Matter or Occupy, but we're watching it from the news perspective, and the news had tied into the police helicopters. And what they did was they corralled all of these protesters onto the Brooklyn Bridge. And ironically, just a couple weeks ago, or maybe 5 weeks ago, 10 weeks ago, whatever, I can't tell time anymore, Christina and I and Andrew just had walked across this bridge a couple weeks ago for the Black Lives Matter protests that happened. And we were freely allowed to get across where the cars were. But this was not the case. Police were specifically trying to get groups into a corral so that they could, you know, put them in the paddy wagons. And if you know anything about paddy wagons, named after my people, which are paddies. And that's how you get the term paddy wagons, which is where they put drunk Irish people. So anyways, I kind of had this kid Jared's head in my mind, knowing that he was more of an anarchist, more of a person that a rabble rouser. And I've had residual guilt about the way that a lot of the conversations that I'd had with him over the years had gone, because even though I felt like he was probably not on the right course, and even though I felt like a lot of people that whose lives were affected by this guy were, you know, in the right spirit, a lot of things turned south. And in this instance, the police were on the bridge, and there was going to be a fracas. And what had happened was, at some point, they clashed with the police, and a cop went down. A cop was on the ground. And the footage was of this kid, Jared, then kicking the shit out of this cop, and immediately going to jail, and then going into the system, getting not the greatest lawyer, and going to prison. And over the years, I've kept up with this guy's life, and you know, as much as like this has been something that I've carried with me for over years, you know, from that reading to Occupy to this company that I had where it almost went belly up because of this kid's ideas. I just read about him the other day, and he's doing all this writing about prison reform from prison. And I did some of the reading of what he's trying to accomplish, and he's pretty much dead on at this point. And he's taken some of the writing and some of the philosophy and some of the things that he's read about anarchy and applied it in a much more mature way. And I'm not saying that he's probably all mentally there, but there's an irony to his story that at some point, all of these decisions that he's made over the years has gotten to the point where people are now understanding how important, and Andrews is someone that I know that works a lot in prison reform and is touched by that. And so I was really impressed with where he'd gotten and how that there was a turnaround. Anyways, it's a pretty disjointed story, and I knew it was going to be, but it's interesting how people can weave in and out of your life and get to a point where, even though it might be terrible, these things that you learn over the years kind of get you to a place where maybe, you know, we can see some good come out of it, including with the penal system and how fucked up that is. So that's my story.
Thank you.
And it probably went over 10 minutes.
I think people's lives tend to go over 10 minutes. So
thank you. Very good. Thank
you.
Can I
say one thing about that?
Is that, yeah.
First of all, I was with Terrence all the way during that entire thing. So I really understand what happened to Terrence. I was looking at Terrence. I miss Terrence. I need to talk to...
I'm here. You gotta
put me back. He's still there. He's just not spotlighted anymore.
I just want to say that thank you for telling that story, because I've been waking up at night thinking about him, and not you, Jared. Jared read for me for Rabbit Tales, and he was one of the most brilliant philosophical readers I've ever experienced in my life. But I did see him bust up a cop on a bridge. Mm-hmm. And it was very difficult. That was a very difficult time to be like, okay, where do we balance our activism with our violence and with our, when we use our voices toward violence and when we actually use violence? And that was very disturbing. And he was like the quintessential epitome of showing that. And when I read it at Octopi, whatever you call it.
Occupy
Wall Street. It was at the, pretty much at the end of it. And
in the People's Library, like in the heart of the library.
Yeah. And I was saying something like, my dad was a cop under Rizzo, and he left because, well, Rizzo and racism. So he left under that stuff. But what Jared did and said was very important, very good, but it was very upsetting to see how it manifested. So that's amazing that you followed up with him. I feel sad for that guy, because I have to say, I've met many brilliant people in my life, and he is absolutely a brilliant person. He's flawed, but very brilliant. I would read anything he writes any day, even though he's a very violent, Sorry, did I totally?
No, you're fine. That? No. These things braid together, these stories.
They do braid together. And also, I hired Terrence, guys, and he does not want to admit that. I hired him. He would never have been a part of Rabbit Movers. I was the start of it, and he was
the first.
And that's why I love him.
First manager.
I know. But yeah.
You were the first manager.
No, I cleaned the socks out of the coffee cups. And yes, I was...
Anyways, we got to get back to the storytelling. Anyways.
It's always a very important story to tell. And people need to know that was really in crux, a part of, I have to say, why Terrence started How to Build a Fire. Because I think you were stimulated by the whole Occupy Wall Street thing. And then you started this whole thing. It took your art to a different place that was so powerful and so great. And you've, look how many lives you've changed by doing that. That's amazing. And you also helped me with rabbit tails. I mean, you were the only kind of like constant helper. That's very important that you pick up on those things. You're like, let's take this and make it into a bigger story. So anyway, we're here about stories. That's why I wanted to say that. I'll shut up now.
You're fine. Thanks, Kate.
Thanks, Kate. Mm-hmm. And thank you, Terrence, for all that you have done for this community and for sustaining it and being, Kate, like you said, one of those very constant people in support of community, whether it is in a close and haphazard moment or in something that you have the space to sustain. I think you really do put a huge amount of solid ground under people. And that is incredibly valuable. So Terrence, thank you for sustaining us as the How to Build a Fire community.
And thank you for being able to choose pairs of hosts who create magical seasons. Like, I wouldn't have met Christina if you didn't pair me with her as a host. And oh my God, how gray and pathetic my life would be had I not met Christina.
I know, you're slowly stealing her from Andrew. Pretty soon it's just going to be the Christina and Andrew. Or Christina and Andrew.
Don't tell Andrew.
It's okay. But there are two very exciting people that Terrence, you can introduce.
That Terrence needs to introduce.
Okay, yeah. So really quickly, I want to take this time to everybody unmute yourselves at this point so that we can give Stacie and Christina a round of applause for such a good season.
Woo! Yay! One of the things that, so much fun.
It was not easy, though, from a group of people that were able to get together, drink wine, go out afterwards, witness albino frogs, and you know, laugh, cry, hug, kiss each other on the cheeks every week to going online. And I really do appreciate the fact that you transitioned so well from such a easy time to a much more difficult time, and you did it somewhat seamlessly. So you too.
Thank you, Terrence.
And that light, I'm going to actually pitch it back to you two in a second after I introduce our next two hosts, who are Lily and Jackie, Lily and Jackie, who I'm pointing at on my screen because I'm an idiot. Lily and Jackie are going to be amazing hosts. And one of the things that we're going to do in transition is we're going to bring stories themselves back to open source. So what's going to happen hopefully in September is that the storytellers are gonna go back and they're gonna share a Zoom camera and a Zoom mic, and then the audience will still be on Zoom. So we're gonna make an attempt to socially distance and wear masks and still commune, the six of us. So Jackie and Stacie and Christina, if you have any advice, now is the time to give it, and please introduce these two wonderful women.
Just have fun and invite people who you wouldn't think to invite. And yeah, and it always turns out fantastically. And it doesn't hurt if you fall madly in love with your co-host.
It doesn't hurt at all, except when it comes to the end of your season and yes, your heart breaks a little bit for how your relationship may have to change. But it's okay. Change is growth. My only advice for how to build a fire is to trust and sit with the deep joy and sometimes the silence that appears, because both are loud in their own ways and important.
One other quick note. I wanted to say thank you to Reese. I've heard bits and pieces of that story, that specific story, over the years, and that story really has touched me in a way that it's changed who I am, and we are really, really blessed, and I don't use that word because I kind of hate it, but we're really blessed to have you in our lives, and the things that you've gone through have helped us to go through the things that we've gone through. So thank you, Reese.
Thank you. I feel the same way about all of you. That's, I think, why we do this in a community, to know we're not alone in the human experience, which is not always, which is painful often.
Yeah.
Sometimes you think that it's tetanus. It's often not.
And I think it might be pregnancy, but it's just a panic attack.
It's okay. It's just a panic attack, guys. Don't worry.
No, just.
On that note, I'm going to introduce Lily White. Hello, Lily. I'm so excited to bring in our first host for season 7. Yes. Y'all are hosting your first How to Build a Fire next month, right?
Correct.
Right. September 25th.
Beautiful. September 25th is when we can see Jackie Reason and Lily White. We'll be on Zoom, but y'all will be in the gallery, which is so beautiful. So Lily White grew up in the Middle West and moved to New York City to pursue a career in music. For the last 30 years, she has played saxophone, flute, sang, taught piano, and released 4 CDs of her own jazz groups. White has always been a storyteller, recently returning to school to earn an MFA in nonfiction. Her essays are often autobiographical and have appeared in the Southampton Review, Brevity, Caffeine Press, and the New York Times. She has spent the last 4 summers teaching creative writing to young people in Vermont, which sounds lovely. Lily White, welcome and thank you and good luck. Mwah!
Thank you. Say again? Oh, yeah. All right. Yeah. I guess I was thinking about this, what's going on now. And so I was thinking about charity, what charity means in these crazy times. And it reminded me of a story back in 1995 when I got to go to Ghana in West Africa for a month to a small village called Kopaia that's about 4 hours north of Accra, which is the capital. And the reason I went there was because my African drumming teacher in New York, Abraham Adzidnia, had grown up there and had still had very much contacts there. And so he had built Western housing, you know, with beds and mosquito nets and all that, for other drumming students that came. And I just thought, oh, that's out of my price range, I'm not gonna go. And so I would go to the drumming class, and I don't know if you've ever done Ghanaian drumming, but it's pretty awesome. It's like, there are all these different kinds of drums, different sizes, and everybody knows kind of a part. It's sort of like jazz music because everybody's playing their part and it all has to fit together, but it's preset what you're gonna do. And at the beginning, it sounds sort of like this mishmash, especially us, because we're Americans, we're unfamiliar. And then all of a sudden it'll come together and it'll start grooving, and the music just goes, whoosh, you know, just goes like totally, you know, becomes something else, and it's really magical. So it was pretty fun and I liked doing it, and I felt like it helped in my musical education. But anyway, one of the guys in my class, Rob, had actually gone to Ghana with his sister 6 years earlier, maybe 7 years earlier, and had gone there, and he said he was drumming, and he noticed all these kids around, and he was like, well, why are these kids not in school? It's like the daytime. And they were like, oh, we don't have a school here. And he was pretty shocked. And so he and his sister went back to New Jersey, and they raised a bunch of money. They made some films. Kathy is a filmmaker. And they partnered with the people of that region, Kopaia, and they brought money, they built a school, and so every year they would go back. They formed this Bloomington, New Jersey, Kopaia, Ghana sister school thing. And they would go back every year and they would monitor the school, like if there was bad principal or what was going on in the school. And Anyway, so that's just a sideline. So they were going to have their first sixth grade class graduate. And Robin said, "You want to come?" And I was like, "Oh, that would be great. I would love to do that." So serendipitously, some cop hit my car and crashed it. Not terribly, but just while it was parked. And it was in front of a huge number of cops all drinking beer on the street. So it was like, he had to leave a note because I guess that's what you do, you know, that's the right thing to do. So he said, "Let's settle without the insurance company." I was like, "Okay, that sounds reasonable." And I got, you know, an estimate, it was like $900. And then I just called Air Afrique just to see how much it would cost to go. And it was $900. So I started parking my car about three blocks away because I just never paid to have the dents taken out. So this guy basically paid for me to go to Africa. So anyway, we get there. It was a pretty amazing experience. And I got to hear all this music, and I brought this tape recorder, and I taped a lot of stuff, and I painted the school, and we made road signs so people would slow down in front of the school. And there was this big party afterwards where they had the graduation. Anyway, it was just this total different culture to be in, where instead of school teachers being brought up on charges, they would like poison them and shit. So it was kind of crazy, but there was a lot of weird shit happening. But it was just a different culture. So at the end of this whole experience, it was time to go, and Rob said, "Oh, you know, if you want to give some of your clothes away to a family that, you know, needs them, that might be appreciated." And so there was this family that had a girl who was, her legs were bent and she couldn't walk, and she was going through adolescence, so a lot of stuff she was kind of growing out of. So I thought, okay, I'll give some of my t-shirts to her, being the good Christian that I was. And I also wanted to make room in my luggage for the shit that I bought, like some fabric. So anyway, I'm heading over to this girl's hut, and this guy stops me, and he's like, "Where are you going with those t-shirts?" And I was like, "Well, I'm going to give them to Efua and her family because, you know, she needs t-shirts." And the guy said, "Why are you going to give them to her? She can't use them." And I was like, "Well, she can." And he was just like, "No, I'm a healthy man. I have five children. I have a job. I can use them more than she can." And I was kind of taken aback. And because, you know, I was raised in the Methodist church, and one big takeaway was that you're supposed to give stuff to people that are in need, right? And I, you know, didn't say anything right away, but I realized, you know, Christianity wasn't really here yet. It was still an animist area of the country. And so I said, "Nah, I'm really sorry, but I've already decided I'm going to give them to her." So anyway, this interaction stuck with me over the years. And I kept thinking about it, you know, how was it that we had such different worldviews? And for that matter, you know, why was it so important that I wanted to unload my t-shirts on this girl? Was it because it was the right thing to do? Or was it because it just made me feel better, you know? Was that how Christianity worked? Anyway, it made me question my whole motivation. So flash forward to 2020 and to today, and it's 6 months into this crazy global pandemic, and my pretty well-to-do neighborhood of Park Slope is starting to show signs of strain. There's like a woman that begs outside the Chase Bank that seems very lucid when I talk to her, but then she'll just pee right on the sidewalk in front of everybody. And when I go for my daily walk in Prospect Park, there's like fires and there's guys huddled around the fires. And it's like, you know, it's clear that they're living there. And I don't think it's just a lark. I think they're really homeless. And I wonder what they're going to do in the winter. And, you know, I was still okay at the beginning of the pandemic. But, you know, I'm a musician. I lost all a bunch of my work. All the restaurants were closed, and as we know. And I taught piano, and I could do that on Zoom, but I didn't have that many students. And a big chunk of my money is renting out. I have a vacation rental downstairs. And suddenly, nobody's coming. So it's like, ooh, getting kind of crazy. And I was, to top things off, my husband left me after 25 years, just overnight, no warning, and decided he was going to run off with somebody he met on vacation. So my heart was broken, and I was trying to deal with that. And the only way I figured I could stay sane was, you know, to try to stay busy. So I wanted to volunteer, and, you know, so I had cut off all the things that, like, were the automatic, you know, withdrawals, like the Save the Children and the Oxfam and the NPR donations and all that shit. I cut that off. Cable TV, well, maybe I kept that. I need to do something, right? But I was thinking, like, what am I going to do, you know, when winter came? So I figured it was important to stay busy helping others. So I got this gig where I was delivering food to these old Russian people in Brighton Beach, and I would enlist my daughter, and we'd carry these giant bags filled with, as far as I could tell, giant jars of mayonnaise and pickles. I don't know, they were very heavy. And the people were so nice, and they would try to tip us, and we were like, no, no, no. And I chipped in at this local soup kitchen, which has been around forever. It's called Chips. And they said, yeah, we're only doing grab and go meals. So we had to make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. So I would get like 8 loaves of bread and 2 giant things of peanut butter every Saturday, and like 2 things of, you know, Smuckers, because that's the best. And we would make, you know, 100 sandwiches and bring them in. And I also started making the face masks, like Stacy. And I had this little deal going with, like, I would make the face masks, and people in the neighborhood would pay what they wanted to, and then I'd put it toward the food, you know, because I was like, you know. So anyway, this was like a thing I was doing for a while. And the big change was the pandemic insurance. So thank God for the PUA, right? So that clicks in. And so for a while, at least, I can sleep well at night. And I buy myself a case of wine. I join sailing club, you know, there's like this little sailing club. You know, and I restarted all the monthly donations, the NPR, slowly, slowly, you know, like becoming that middle-class lady that I'd grown accustomed to being. And I figured, you know, that's the best way to give to charity. You don't, no muss, no fuss. You write a check, boom, you're done. You don't have to have any weird conversations with people, or, you know, risk getting a disease going up an elevator. Anyway, so after this long season, you know, of feeling sorry for myself, I'm ready to live it up. And, but I kept thinking about, like, is that the only reason that I lost interest in the charitable acts, the direct things? Because, like, when I first was in pain in the winter, I'd come out of the marriage counselor, I'd be crying, and I'd be like feeling terrible, and I'd see there's this guy that would beg at the R station, and I'd always, like, if I was feeling particularly bad, I'd give him like $10 or $5 or something. And it was almost as if, you know, the worse off I was feeling, the more I would give. It was almost like, like I was thinking, if I give this person money, then maybe, you know, the powers that be will not bring me any more bad news. And I don't know, it was like this Christian charity thing sort of became more like the old-fashioned sacrifice, you know, sacrificing a goat or something to get something in return. So I'm just thinking about that lately. So now the PUA has ended. So I don't know how this is all going to work out for all of us. People who are, you know, getting money like me, you know, we were the ones that were better off anyway. The ones who could navigate the forms and the computers and all that junk. And the people who are suffering, you know, from hunger or homelessness or trauma or mental illness, they're still going to be around, probably till the end of time, unless something changes with the political will. But the question is how to respond personally. You know, do we all have to hit rock bottom in order to be spurred to real empathy? I mean, I guess after this year, I'm more prepared than anybody to deal with insecurity. But there's a limit, because if we all hit rock bottom, then there'll be nothing more to give. So, I don't know. There's something there's something nice about helping people directly that I got that I'm not able to get by writing a check or direct deposit, I guess, now. And I was just thinking about like the drumming and how like when we all are drumming our different parts, you know, when it all comes together, it really becomes something magical. So I guess I just hope that we can all do that. We can continue to stay together in the midst of all this craziness. And that's all. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Lily.
Thank you, Lily. And welcome to your new season of How to Build a Fire.
Yeah, it starts right now. Right now.
It does start right now. You told your story, so of course it starts right now.
Welcome. I am proud and excited to hand it over to you.
Yes.
Jackie.
And to close out our finale show, I'm going to introduce our last storyteller, Jackie Reason.
Yes, Jackie Reason.
Hey, Jackie, come on.
Oh, wait. Did I forget to unspotlight you? Sorry. and now I'm going to introduce Jackie. Jackie Reason is an Afro-Caribbean womanist writer born in the U.S. Virgin Islands. She's a Bronx-based author and playwright raised in the Bronx before it became the boogie down. Reason is a lifelong educator committed to helping others tell stories of identity and intersectionality. She writes memoir to examine her life and its place in the world. Reason is a wounded storyteller telling complex tales of Black womanhood to disrupt labels of other and marginalized. These acts of healing allow her to do more than survive. Reason is a Voices of Our Nation's Arts Fellow, Yay Vona, in memoir and is published in the Bronx Memoir Project, Volumes 2 and 3. Her poetry can be found in online publications, Digging Deep, Finding Self, and The Bleeding Typewriter. She currently collaborates on the pre-production of her original play, Under the Bridge, and co-hosts the new season of How to Build a Fire. Woo! Open Source Gallery. Everyone, please welcome Jackie. And Jackie, I'm going to stop you.
Oh my goodness. Hi. What a wonderful evening. Thank you, ladies. Of course, you have left Lily and I a lot to live up to. We're not as ambitious as you two, so we're going to work it out.
That for 1 minute, not 1 minute.
Okay, we'll see. But we're excited. You know, it's something new for us to embark upon. So, and I got here just like the rest of you guys. Terrence like jammed me in a corner. Just kidding. I said no first, good, and then. Something kicked in, but I'm happy to take on the challenge. So I will jump right in because, you know, I know what time it is, and thank everybody. You know, I know there will be a formal thank you for coming. And I've got a friend on this call, and she supports me in everything. And I happen to say to her, here she is. and I happen to say to her, I'm going to talk about someone tonight, and she's probably one of the only other people in the world that knows our relationship. So I started college at 29, and I guess the notable thing about starting college, besides being what they called an adult learner, was after Soch 100, my first day of school, I gave birth to my third daughter. So, that's like a whole other story. But anyway, I made it back to school. And when you're an adult starting school, becoming a freshman, you look for allies. And usually it was other adult women like myself. And mine came in the form of a white girl named Billie Jean. And we weren't like these great friends. I remember some of the other students would talk about how they were had study sessions and they baked cookies and stuff like that. We weren't doing that kind of stuff. But we, like, I would go hang out with her during the breaks and take, I don't smoke, but I'd go on the smoke breaks with her and stuff like that. And nothing deep, just idle conversation, because it was a way of us supporting each other. So we met in a, really it was like a high school algebra class, but at that time they were giving college credit for it. And we suffered through that and saw each other in different classes as the years went by. And then eventually saw each other again by the time we got to grad school. And by then, both of us were working full time. Billie Jean, I have to tell you a little bit about her. She was tough as nails. She was, when I met her initially in undergrad, she was an over the, what do you call it? Over the road, long haul truck driver. And by grad school, she'd started doing like small distances and stuff like that. And, you know, grad school was a better experience because it wasn't all that rote stuff. And we grew a little closer. Well, one day she came in and she told us that she had stage 4 lung cancer. So she continued coming to school and being this really upbeat person. When she lost her hair from the chemo and stuff, she'd take off her cap and show us that she said she had a lovely round head, all that good stuff. And when she couldn't come to school anymore, she started emailing us, like a group of us, every morning. And they were these badass emails, and they were amazing. And I would feel bad. I'm like, what do I have to complain about today? Absolutely nothing. And she did more for us than it felt like we were able to do for her. So, you know, eventually we were talking, and my girlfriend and I were like, we've got to do breakfast. And she said, you know, I'll let you know when we can do it. And so one day she sent me an email and she said, it's time for that breakfast. So my girlfriend and I went to University of Chicago Hospital to see her. And when we got there, Billie's mom was there, Billie Jean's mom. And her mom's name was Lois. And by then she was my coworker. And Lois, she was kind of a badass as well. She was an academic advisor. And we had a semester or a year where we only got a 1% raise. And Lois, so the person that was our director bought a bunch of Georgia O'Keeffe framed prints, like really big ones, and had them up on the wall. And Lois would bring her students in and she'd say to the students, what do you think about this purple pussy? That's my razor. So I get up there and I see Lois and her son-in-law and they're doing a bedside vigil. Billie Jean she's got a little bit of hair on the top of her head that's grown back, and she's wearing an oxygen mask. Her breathing is labored. And we talked to Billie Jean. She managed to, couldn't talk by that point really, but she managed to smile. And I was able to look in her eyes and stuff. And so I did what I was asked to do at that point, which was talk to her, tell her it was okay it was okay to go home, to transition, whatever the term was at that time. And I don't know when everybody left the room. And I'll just say it wasn't like the movies. No alarms went off, none of that stuff. But at some point I realized that Billie Jean had stopped breathing. And so just to like emphasize, it wasn't like in the movies. I was scared shitless because I was like, oh my God, don't be dead. okay? Because I've got to now go tell Lois that her daughter is gone. So I find a nurse, or I grab a nurse, and she's like, I'm like, you know, telling her, I'm like, I think she's, and they're like, no, it can't be. Anyway, so she goes, I'll get the doctor and I'll get Lois. And I'm like terrified, right? So Lois comes in, the doctor comes in, and they say, Billie Jean's gone. And Lois asked me, she's like, what did she say? And I said, she didn't say anything. I said, she just smiled, you know? And so it was like, it was very difficult because Lois and I weren't that tight. And it was like the last thing that I expected. So that predicament put us into, I ended up helping Lois with the arrangements and stuff like that, and take care of putting Billie Jean to rest. And we had her like her wake or her repast in a her favorite pizza shop, which also had a bar. So it was like we went in this and just filled this restaurant. The younger people were in the bar drinking pitchers of beer. We had some balloons, a candle, and that was how we were able to, you know, send Billy off. And Lois and I remained friends for a little while. And, but basically that was it. We ended up, you know, we drifted apart and stuff like that. So for a long time, I felt like I had, you know, I felt really uncomfortable about what had happened. But later on, I learned that a lot of times when people are dying or on their deathbed and family is around, they're afraid to let go, and because they don't want to leave them. And so the likelihood is when I came in and was able to be with Billie Jean, she was able to let go and you know, transition. So that's why I came up with this story. I didn't know what anybody else was going to do. But I've also come to think of it as it was the last time that she and I could support each other. Mm-hmm. And for that reason, it was a beautiful transition. So that's my story.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie.
Very good. Thank you, Jackie.
Wow.
Thank you, Jackie.
Welcome, Lily and Jackie, to your season.
Yeah.
Thank you. A round of
applause for Lily and Jackie entering the seventh season.
Welcome to season seven.
I will be there next month on the 25th.
Okay. Last Friday of the month.
The last Friday of the month. If you forget the date like I do, last Friday of the month. Jackie, beautiful, beautiful Jackie, and wonderful, wonderful Lily. We'll see,
I'm so excited for the two of you. I can't wait to hear the stories that are going to come out in your season.
All right. Thank you very much.
Hey, Stacie. Thanks,
hey, Christina.
Thanks for being the host of How to Build a Fire. You're amazing.
By the way, Christina, I think you've been an incredible host for How to Build a Fire.
A stop. Couldn't have done it without you.
I'm in love for some music.
Really couldn't have.
You need to get a separate room, you two.
We can't put you in a breakout room if you want to be in a breakout room.
Oh, that's true. I know how to do that.
Why didn't we think of that before?
You need any tips and tricks of Zoom?
Call Race.
I might call you.
We'll take you up on that.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, Terrence.
Yeah. Welcome,
everybody. Thanks, everyone. For being
Luis, what were you going to say?
Thank you so much.
The other folks that we couldn't do it without are all of our wonderful guests from this season. We've had a string of beautiful people, some of whom are in the audience tonight, and some of whom couldn't be here, some of whom have passed away. And some of whom have, you know, transitioned into other things altogether. So a quick moment of like, mwah, for our storytellers from this season. and our wonderful, wonderful audience have just been delightful from all corners of the globe all year.
I know, the pandemic allowed us to become an international event. We had folks from Australia, we have folks from all over the country. It's been amazing.
Yeah.
What is Mariah Carey doing on my screen right now?
Parents.
Oh, here it comes. Here it comes.
Peace now.
What is happening?
Parents is giving us the gong.
Drama.
Parents, I can't sleep.
You can't quit. You can't quit.
I'm the gate on this one.
I love you all. Let's thank you.
Good night, everybody. Thank you so much for
good night, everyone. Good night. And thank you.
Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you, everyone. Mariah's going to stay in forever. Did Stacie leave? Oh my God! You sent Stacie away with Mariah Carey.
Your glasses. Are...
Good night, everybody. I'll see you later.
Jackie and Lily. Lily.
Oh no way.
Jackie and Lily.
Oh, you can't see me. Oh.
Hey, Reese, what kind of films do you make? No, Reese is not.
Hey, Christina, if you go to my friends list, you can definitely hook up with Reese.
Yeah, I will. I need to talk to Reese about films.
You guys had a wonderful season.
Yeah. I'm really sad and excited.
And it ended with Mariah Carey.
Yeah, that's your fault. Hey, Jackie, the other piece of advice I would give for the season.
Yeah, I think I can mute you. There we go. There we go.
Is it Terrence's head? And he's the worst. Yeah, Terrence is the worst and also the best. So just remember to slap him shut.
That I got. And I already knew the rest, so it should be an interesting season.
Yay! I'm so excited. Have you started asking people for your first session?
I kind of. I've like given a little bit of a hint, but I haven't put the hard push, but I will.
Ah, it's all right. Don't worry. Like 90% of the people that I got to come came, agreed to it in the last like 3 days before the day. It's incredibly nerve-wracking. Please, 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 I hope that you ask people who respond quicker than they did for me, but holy shit.
I will work on it. Melanie, how are you?
I'm good. I don't know if this, can you hear me?
Yeah, it works.
We can hear you.
Isn't she gorgeous? Hold on. Terrence's fancy grunge wife. I love it.
I didn't expect you to be up walking around. I mean, not that I thought you were like bedridden, but.
No, I know. I still have a broken foot, but I'm still kind of like shuffling around.
How's your moon boot?
Oh my God, I got these like super cheap EVA, like soft, squishy, fake Birkenstocks, and they're so much better.
Nice.
Okay.
Yeah. I guess I idea. Like, I wonder if, like, from being inside and not having to, like, go outside and, like, wear shoes, like, are we going to have, like, baby feet? Like, soft baby feet?
Yeah, I'm not having that experience.
I've noticed that when I wear my sandals for more than, like, a couple of hours at a time, then I try and put my, like, real shoes on, and it's like, ooh, they're tight. No.
Yeah, man, because, like, your feet spread out.
Yeah, that's what I'm dealing with for sure.
Yep. Yeah. No, my friend is, like, a shoe designer, and she was like, man, we're screwed. I'm so screwed. I'm not going to have a job. And I was like, no, you will, because everybody's feet are getting fatter.
And we're
like the freaking Flintstones.
We're all like, yes, Birkenstocks, keep them in fashion.
You know what? I'm 40 now, so I don't care what's in fashion.
That is not true, bitch. You just shaved the side of your head. Uh-uh.
No.
Yeah, you're fashion as fuck. You can't tell me shit about not caring. Uh-uh.
No, this is like a major, like, I was forced to go and, like, leave from work because I guess I was, like, not producing, and I was, like, having a mental breakdown that they could visually see. And they were like, you've got a lot going on. I think that you need to take a break. And I was like, you know what? I've been here for 13 years and I'm so out of love with this. Like, I've been meaning to break up with you, but now it's like really kicking my ass to find a new job. So I've been applying to like a lot of work. So I've actually not been working for the past month.
Good.
And then you broke your foot, so.
Well, I broke my foot right before. That's like the fucked up thing is that like I didn't take vacation because we had so much going on, and I was in North Carolina in, I'm going to turn this off. This is stupid. I was in North Carolina in like a cabin with like our closest best friends and their kids and Lola and Jamie, who's Sean's wife. Sean is Terry's best friend. And I were just like working. And I didn't take it off for any vacation except for one day on Saturday. Like it was my day to go out and like have fun. And that was the day.
You took a Saturday off?
Well, no, I didn't. Yeah, but like it was, you know, my day, my regular day off. Like I went off to go like have fun. Like I worked all week long. And then that was the day that my foot was broke, and I didn't get to have any fun. I spent all day in the hospital, so I was like, "Oh, are you fucking kidding me?" And then I came back to work.
It's only two people.
Monday, and she was like, "Oh, you've got a lot going on. You should probably take off." And I was like, "You could have fucking told me this like before I worked all while I was on vacation."
Yeah,
I think you should have taken the vacation time.
No, I should have. And that's
yeah.
That's the thing, is like I felt like there was just so much going on, and I was like, oh, I don't know. But
well, I'm
aside, they're hiring so many marketers right now because everybody is like at home. They actually need a lot of digital marketers.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd like to find something that I can do from home also. So
I mean, I don't want to work from home, girl.
Well, it's a different experience for you. Listen,
I was never meant to be like a stay-at-home mom.
No.
My daughter is, so her kids just went back to school. She has four kids.
You're a grandma?
Oh, of eight.
Jackie has like eight grandbabies.
Shut your face.
Oh eight. Eight, right?
Huh?
You have eight grandchildren, right?
I do.
They're beautiful.
Thank
all of
you.
Them, every single one of them is a freaking delight.
Thank you. But my daughter told me that the cable company called her because I think she's into the tetrabyte stage at this point because they could not give her the amount of, well, one of our theories, I have a 14-year-old grandson, was that he was selling the Wi-Fi password. They said that they were streaming the equivalent of like 43 devices.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Oh my
so
God.
She's not having the greatest time either. I guess that was the point of that whole story. working from home, dealing with hilarious. The kids, the husband, all the good
it's
stuff.
It's fucking tough. It's hard. Yeah. It's like, oh my God, I have the smallest bladder. It's like once I sit down and go to the bathroom, then somebody, like, it's time for lunch or it's time for to feed the cats. Or it's like, somebody needs something.
We'll see what happens because, you know, we're starting, like, I don't know, I know a little bit of what Brooklyn looks like because I was there the other day when I met Terrence and Lily and stuff. But the Bronx is slowly, where I am, is slowly starting to open up. Like, you can go to the park and I'm starting to see guys playing basketball again and stuff like that. So, you know, signs of life. But we don't know for how long. We can only see what this winter brings, right?
I was surprised you didn't tell a story about having coronavirus. I mean, that was a big transition.
Eventually I'll write and stuff, but... No, and I felt like this was a great opportunity to honor Billie Jean. She was just a great lady. And it was really funny because my friend that was on tonight listening, we saw each other when I was in Indiana and she kept saying something about somebody and she was talking about Billie Jean and I didn't even realize it at that moment. But I'll talk to her tomorrow. We'll debrief.
I gotta go, my loves. I'm being dragged away by my beautiful husband.
Oh, is he? I don't know where you are, all that good stuff, but we shall talk soon.
Yes.
Okay. When are you coming back? I need soon. You.
Soon, like in a couple of weeks.
Okay.
Promise.
All right, I gotta go too. I'm taking over a room.
So much. I miss New York so much. So much. Oh my God. There's so many reasons I left here. So many reasons.
All right. We will talk when you get back. Okay. Bye, ladies. Happy healing, Melanie.
Bye, guys. Love you. Thank you. You too. Good night, guys. Love you.
All right. Bye. Love you.